Hi, I'm Matt from Ceramic Materials Workshop, and I'm here today with our video, Crazy for You, the True Story of Glaze Crazing. Of course, we have to answer the question, what is glaze crazing? And it's this fine network of cracks that you find in a lot of glazes. Now, crazing is the technical term for it as a glaze flaw. Now, some people actually like it as a decorative effect, and they'll often call it crackle, but it's the same thing. This is an image of crazing by my mentor, Dr. Carty at Alfred University, and these were taken with a scanning electron microscope. And you can see through the cross section that the craze goes all the way through the glaze and stops inside the clay body. So it does have an effect all the way into the clay. We often stress out about crazing because it's a glaze flaw that we can hear. If you listen, we hear that pinging often as our glaze kiln cools down and gets closer and closer to room temperature. And that pinging is the cracking occurring. And conventional wisdom often tells us that we have to wait until a kiln reaches room temperature to open it up to reduce crazing. The problem is, that's not how it actually works. But before we understand that, let's talk about why crazing is happening. You see, all ceramics have what's called thermal expansion, which means they are materials that expand and contract when they heat and cool. And the problem with glazes and clays is that those two materials have different thermal expansion. So your glaze will expand at a different rate than the clay. And the problem is that this creates a compression-tension relationship. But let's imagine we're cooling down our kiln and our clay and glaze are contracting because that's the opposite side of thermal expansion. Now I have to add that this is thermal expansion and not shrinkage. Shrinkage only happens once things shrink, but thermal expansion happens on the way up and our materials contract on the way down. Well, if our clay and our glaze have different thermal expansions, what happens is that the glaze gets pulled, and that pulling creates tension, and ceramics really don't do well in tension. And so as the glaze is pulled, eventually it cracks to relieve that stress. And that cracking ends up being our network of crazes. And they just keep forming more and more until all that stress is released. Now, there are plenty of glazes out there that have no crazing, and that's because the thermal expansion between that glaze and that clay are close enough that none of that tension is created. Of course, something that's really common that we'll see is there are plenty of glazes that will craze on one clay body and not another. And that's because each and every clay body has a different thermal expansion. So the thermal expansion of a glaze might fit just fine on a stoneware, but on a porcelain, the exact same glaze will craze like mad. And this is actually a really good example of why it's got nothing to do with the cooling and everything to do with thermal expansion. And that is a fact. No amount of slow cooling or waiting for the kiln to cool will stop crazing from happening, ever, at all. What you do in the kiln and when you open up that lid makes no difference as to whether or not the glaze will craze. If a glaze is going to craze, it's going to happen no matter what. And in fact, crazing can happen years later. It's not uncommon to hear someone say, I had a pot on the shelf and it crazed 2 years after I got it, or I poured some tea into my teacup and all of a sudden it crazed. Well, those are the results of the tension that did exist in that pot getting released. And it might take time. But at the end of the day, that thermal expansion relationship is based on chemistry. What's the chemistry of our clay body and what's the chemistry of our glaze? This map is an incredible document, and it was created by a scientist named R.T. Stull in 1912. And there's a lot to talk about here, but the most important feature to discuss is this hatch marked region. You see, this map tells us what a glaze is going to do. It's really incredible, but the hatch marked region tells us if a glaze is going to craze, because that crazing behavior is based on the chemistry of the glaze. And in fact, let's look at two different glazes. You see here, we've got one glaze that is crazed quite heavily in the other glaze that's not crazed at all. Well, these two glazes are actually exceptionally similar chemically, except they fall in different areas on the map. Shockingly enough, the crazed glaze falls right in the middle of the crazing region of the map, and the uncrazed glaze falls outside of it because the behavior is predictable based purely on chemistry. Of course, there is a greater question of, is crazing bad? And that's a little bit up for interpretation. As I said, some people like crazing as a decorative effect, but there are two concerns that people will often express with questions about crazing. The first of which is it going to grow bacteria? And the answer is yes, it can grow bacteria. Now, is it going to do it all the time? That really depends. This was an image sent to me by a friend who lives in another country that's very hot and humid at all times, and their water processing might not be up to Western standards as far as removing a lot of impurities within the water. But these were pots that were sitting around, and this person takes exceptionally good care of their pots and washes them thoroughly, but there was still a mold or a bacteria that was able to grow inside the crazes. They are open. It's an open network of cracks that water and bacteria can get inside and grow in. And if your clay body is not vitrified, if it's not fully glassy, then the water can also get into the clay body at that point and, yes, grow mold and bacteria. The other question about crazing is that of strength, and it is a fact that crazing makes a clay body substantially weaker. This is some research again by Dr. Carty, where he did a beautiful test. He compared a clay body unglazed to a clay body that had been the same clay body with a crazed glaze on it, and saw how strong the two bodies were. Well, what he found is that the body with a crazed glaze could be 60 or 65 or 75% weaker than exactly the same clay body with a craze in it. Because the problem is going back to how the craze stops. You see, the crazes stop inside the clay, and that creates what's called a critical failure location. That's a place where if you put a little bit of stress on that body, say by knocking it around in the sink, or just banging up against something in day-to-day use, that crack will just keep going really fast, whereas the unglazed uncrazed clay body doesn't have that crack already started, so it's much, much stronger. Of course, we all want to know how to deal with crazing, and there are several solutions, and some of them are better than others. The two best solutions are, one, keep your glaze application thin. There is certainly a role that the thickness of the glaze has as far as crazing. As you can see in this sample, with two dips it's crazed, with one dip it's not. The problem with this as a solution is if the glaze is crazing with two dips, it's very likely to craze with one dip, if not eventually, or if the dip is a little bit thick. So it does work, it's not a perfect solution. Of course, as crazing is a chemistry problem, there should be a chemistry solution. Now, if you go out and read books and the web, you're gonna find a lot of answers on how to fix crazing, and I'm not gonna address most of them because I don't particularly care for most of them. But the one I will say is quite often you'll read people saying to add some lithium carbonate to their glaze. I don't support this advice at all, because by adding lithium carbonate, you're going to change the durability of that glaze, along with potentially the color, the firing temperature, and the texture. It's not a good solution. And the interesting thing is that Stoll's map here tells us exactly how to fix a glaze with crazes. And in fact, we saw it in our previous two glazes. Those two glazes are the same, except that they have a slight tweak to their chemistry. You see, the two glazes have different amounts of clay and flint in them. And very simply, you want to add 1.25% flint and 1% clay to this glaze. And the way that you do this is you take your original glaze and make some incremental additions. So you make a version that's got 1.25% and 1%, and a second one that's got 2.5% and 2%, and then 3.75% and 3%, and then 5% and 4%, etc., onward and upward, and you'll slowly watch your crazing go away until you get a nice stable glaze. It's a really quite effective result that gets rid of crazing a lot of the time. And it's a beautiful little solution right there in the chemistry. Of course, there's a lot more to learn about crazing and how glazes work in general. And if you'd like to learn more about how your glazes work, we have a lot more options for you at Ceramic Materials Workshop. We have our newest online on-demand workshop, Glaze of Our Lives, Understanding Glazes for the Beginner, which is available for you now. And if you look below in the description, you'll find a coupon code for 50% off that workshop. We also have Glazed and Confused, Understanding the Unity Molecular Formula, where we go into that map and find out what's really going on in there and what's going on with this thing, the Unity Molecular Formula, that you may have heard of. We also have full courses in Clay and Glaze Science for Artists. These are 12-week long in-depth courses designed for ceramic artists of all levels, and you can find out about more of what we have to offer at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com.